So the goal for today is to talk about how we can translate triple integrals into iterated integrals. So that way we can calculate their value using the technique of partial integration, which we discussed yesterday. Now, what I'd like to begin by doing is just establishing for the record the notation that we use for triple integrals. So we'll be given some kind of description of a three-dimensional region, which I'll refer to by the capital letter D. And then we'll be given this quantity, which starts off by having three integral symbols, subscript the region D, a function of 1, 2, 3 variables closed by a dV on the right-hand side, where V here stands for volume, similar to how A for a double integral, the A stood for area. V is for volume here. This represents a cumulative total of the outputs of the function over the region D. And as we discussed yesterday, one particular example would be if the function of three variables represented the density of an object at a point. If you integrate the density of a three-dimensional object, then you will get the total mass of that three-dimensional object. So let's get into the business of turning triple integrals over a region D into an iterated triple integral. And to begin with, we're going to only discuss the case where the order of integration that we're using has z as the first variable. So order of integration, either dz, dy, dx, or dz, dx, dy. But what we discuss here will only apply to the case that z is the first variable of integration, 2 out of the 6 possible orders. And for our running example, let's consider the following problem, where we're asked to set up an iterated triple integral for some generic function f of x, y, z over the region D, which is described as follows. It's between the plane z equals 2 and the hemisphere z equals 16 minus x squared minus y squared. So step number one of this process. First, I want you to go in and I've identified two different functions, a function which we call f of xy and a function which we call g of xy. Both of these are two variable functions. The first function should correspond to the surface which bounds your region on the top. And the second function corresponds to the surface which bounds your region on the bottom. And actually, I think I'm going to go in and I'm going to call this H instead of F because I'm concerned that it might be confusing to have F as the integrand and also as this limiter here. So I'm going to call this H. I'm going to call this H. Now let's see what this process looks like in our running example. Here is our x, y, and z axes. And I'm going to graph the hemisphere, root 16 minus x squared minus y squared. It's the hemisphere of radius 4. And then the plane z equals 2 is a constant output at a height of 2. So the region that we are interested in, the three-dimensional region, is this sort of cap shape that is squeezed between the hemisphere and the plane. And looking at this picture, we can see that the pink hemisphere is the surface that is on top of the region, whereas the blue plane is the surface that is bounding the region from underneath. So the hemisphere square root of 16 minus x squared minus y squared is the top surface. And so that function is going to correspond to the upper innermost limit of your triple integral. The top surface, the equation for the top surface, gives you the upper inner limit. And the bottom surface, the plane, for the constant output of 2 gives you the bottom surface, which in turn gives you the bottom or the lower inner limit for your triple integral. So let's have a look at what we have so far. We have a triple integral with 1, 2, 3 limits of integration. For the innermost limit, we have a lower limit of 2 and an upper limit given by the hemisphere. We have our unknown function here in the integrand. And we know that we're integrating first with respect to z, but we haven't decided yet about what is going on outside of this innermost layer, whether we're going to do dx dy or dy dx. It also remains for us to decide what is happening with the middle limits of integration and these outer limits of integration. So let's move to step 2. Step 2, find the projection. Find the shadow. Find the image of your three-dimensional region D onto the xy plane. In other words, let this region R in the xy plane be the set of all the x and y pairs in your region D. Now let's go back to our running example and let's redraw our surface where you have z equals 2 on the bottom and you have the hemisphere on the top. And imagine that the sun is shining down on this region from above and casting a shadow on the xy plane underneath that, casting a shadow. This three-dimensional region between the hemisphere and the plane is what we're calling the region D. And this disc-shaped shadow, is the region that we are calling R, the projection of D onto the XY plane. Now let's redraw it one more time, but this time on just the X and Y axes. We have this region R on the xy plane, shaped like a disc, the shadow of our three-dimensional region D. What we don't know about this region at the moment is the radius. So let's see if we can do an analysis to figure out what is the radius of this shadow here. Now let's look back at the three-dimensional drawing. And notice that the outer rim, the outer edge of this shadow, the outermost edge of this region, corresponds to this edge in the three-dimensional region where the hemisphere and disk intersect, where the hemisphere passes through the disk, corresponds to the edge of the region. And so let's figure out where the hemisphere and the disk intersect to figure out what is the radius of our region R here in the xy plane. Let's set the equation for the hemisphere, square root 16 minus x squared minus y squared equal to the equation for the plane z equals 2. And if we square both sides, 16 minus x squared minus y squared equals 4, and do a little bit of rearranging, we can now see that the hemisphere and the disk intersect on the circle of radius square root 12. Radius square root 12. So now we have a complete understanding of the projection of the 3D region D onto the xy plane. It's a disk of radius precisely equal to the square root of 12. Now the third step in this process is to treat R as your region and to set up an iterated double integral over the region R, just like we have been doing in the past several days now. So let's go ahead and set up an iterated double integral over the region R. Radius square root 12. Other words, x squared plus y squared equals 12 is the boundary circle. Now we can choose one of two different orders of integration, either dy dx or dx dy. And if you happen to choose the order dy dx, then as usual, you would break this region down into its top layer and bottom layer. On top, we have the upper semicircle, y is the positive square root of 12 minus x squared. And on the bottom of this region, we have the lower semicircle, y equals negative square root 12 minus x squared. And in terms of the x coordinates that we're seeing in this disk, they can extend all the way from the positive radius root 12 on the right to the negative radius root 12 on the left. So these limits of integration from the two-dimensional region R give us our middle and outer integrals. So let's put it all together. We have our integrand, our function of three variables, x, y, and z. Then we found our innermost limits of integration, where z went from 2 on the bottom to the hemisphere on the top. We got that from step number 1. Then in step number 2, to fill out the middle and the outer limits of integration, and then all we had to do was find the old-fashioned double integral limits of the projection onto the xy plane. So we found with the order dy dx that we could use a lower limit of negative root 12 minus x squared and an upper limit of root positive root 12 minus x squared. And the x values went from negative root 12 up to positive root 12. And this is how we would rewrite the integral over the region D using an iterated triple integral. Now, all we had to do was set this up, and we did not have to evaluate it yet at this point. But think about how difficult this will probably be to actually evaluate because of things like square root 16 minus x squared minus y squared. So hopefully there will be some kind of polar equivalent to triple integrals that we can use to more easily deal with regions that have a circle nature to them, such as the one that we have in this problem. But based on just setting it up, we would finish here.